And you can continue, you notice here, that when Isaac moves to a place, he digs a well. Okay? And so it's just a simple lesson in geology, all right? That the Bible can actually be your guide. When you look at the circumstances of the people, like yesterday we learned about food preservation. Where did we learn it from? Genesis 41, the experience of Joseph. Okay? So that is how you can teach somebody about how important it is to preserve food. But I just wanted to, I don't know where my wife is going, I wanted her to come and give us some ideas on how do you teach children from the Bible. So that whatever knowledge they are learning, whether it is maths or whether it is science, they can learn it from with the Bible in mind, so that they can have the Bible as their chief textbook. I think, are you ready or should I? Okay, all right, so you can use it. My wife is the one who teaches most.
So a lot of the times when we are asked about homeschooling, we ask how do you use the Bible as the main textbook. So I'll just give you two main examples that we usually give out. If you open first to Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1, we'll start with verse 1. Actually, we can just... let's just do Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1. And it says, and Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. Verse 2, and she again bare his brother Abel, and Abel was a keeper of sheep, and Cain was a tiller of the ground. You're probably wondering, so what are we teaching our children there? From this concept, we have taught, especially preschoolers, the little ones, maths. So how do we teach maths? We teach them that in the beginning, God created a man, one person. And then from the man, he created a woman, a second person. And so we teach them how many people were there all together. There was one man plus one woman, and that gave two people. So you've taught the simple concept of maths. For some children, abstract concepts are very difficult. 1 plus 1 is 2. And you just tell them 1 plus 1 is 2 and you show them 1 apple plus 1 apple is 2. But when you bring that to something they understand, like in the family, if you are a family with 2 parents and you say a mother and a father, is how many people in the family altogether? 2. And then when you go back to the Bible and you tell them, then Adam and his wife had a son. And so you further the mathematical concept. And you say, so one person, that's another person, that's not their son. How many people are those? 3. So now the child knows they can count 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 3. And then after that you say, and then they had another son whose name was Abel. And so now you add another mathematical concept and you tell them 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 is 4. And you continue that way until your child is able to add up to 10. Because you're just adding once. It's the same thing they do in the schools, except now the focal point is on the Bible. Last term with my children, we were learning about the bladder, how the bladder works in the human body. And we were trying, my husband and I were trying to teach them the concept of humility, which is something very abstract to teach. So we were wondering, so how do we teach the children about humility? We can try and give them examples. That person is very humble. But you know, it's all just a story for kids. And so we took the example of the bladder. And we told them that the bladder does one of the most humble jobs in the body. If you know how the bladder works, it collects all your liquid waste. From your whole body, your kidney processes, all your waste, your liquid waste. from your blood, and it is stored in your bladder. And then you have to go and dispose of that waste. Okay? And the bladder never complains. Unless you mistreat it, it never complains about the job it has to do. And seriously, unless you seriously mistreat your bladder, you don't drink enough water, etc., etc., it does its job the way it's supposed to. And so we were teaching the children that we should also have attributes of humbleness that way. And so the whole concept was to bring it back to the Bible. So we open, I think it's Philippians chapter 2 and verse 8. And it says, "And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself." He, we're talking about here, is Christ. "And became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." So when Christ came to die, he didn't complain about it either. He did it because he loved us enough to die for us. So as you're teaching the children, always pull them back to the object lesson that you find in the Bible. So just as Christ humbled himself, Christ came from mansions of glory, humbled himself to be born in a manger. The same way our bladder was. We eat food, we drink water and whatever, and our livers and our kidneys, etc., process it, and it is put into our bladders, and then when we need to go, we go to the washroom and dispose of that waste. And so, once we had taught that concept, we were wondering, how do we drive this home? Because it's all about our service to others. And so we came up with the idea of teaching the children how to clean the toilets. And we said, it's not a very pleasant job. No one enjoys doing it. I've never met anyone who tells me, that was a great time I had cleaning the toilet, you know? No one enjoys doing it. But it's a humble service you have to do because everyone needs to use the toilet at some point or the other during the day. And so when we're teaching the kids that if you can humble yourself in service to others and be able to clean the toilet so that it can be used just as the way you would like to find it, then that is an act of service for others. It's not only about yourself, but for others. The last example that they gave is we were learning also about seeds last year in science. And we were telling my son especially that when you take a seed, you must plant it, put it in the ground, cover it, give it the condition it needs, right temperature, moisture, for it to grow, germinate and grow. But we also taught that when the seed is put in the ground, the cotyledons, the little pieces of, if you open a bean, it has two sides to it where the shoot is in the middle. Those two pieces have to degenerate. They have to break down in order for the shoot and the root system to take hold. And the object lesson there was like, we have to be like seeds. We must also die to self in order to produce life again. So those are the kind, as long as you, whatever concept you're teaching, so long as you draw the children back to the Bible and back to Christ, you can be able to teach any. As long as the main focus is from the Bible. Amen.
I hope that that helps to demystify making the Bible your chief textbook. My informational teacher always refers me to Psalms 139, verse 40, when he is taking me through some of the, especially anatomy, and he tells me that we are fearfully and wonderfully. Right? So he always has an object lesson in every aspect of the training that I go through. And when you start doing your acquirement of knowledge that way, then you will always have principles that are consistent with the Bible, and also it will help to reinforce that which God would like us to learn about His Word. Okay. Now, I just wanted to, I don't know if I have, it's really very small, it's very brief, but there's quite a lot when you're looking at materials on what you need to learn. Especially for the adults, it should be difficult, but for the children, you will have to search and make sure you look at the books that are available that can teach. There are a few materials here and there that people have tried to put them together to teach biblical concepts. And if you look for them diligently, you can find them and they will help you. But they are not perfect. The only perfect material is the make sure that it is not throwing away the child from the Bible. There's some books that teach maths from, you know, examples that are not real. Examples that, for example, a book is teaching about carbohydrates or about proteins, and they have a picture of meat and milk. So of course that will not be very helpful for the child, because I am sure it has been difficult for us to think otherwise, that you can survive without meat. And it's because of that picture of a glass of milk and a piece of meat. Because that picture is ingrained in our mind that the only best source of protein is meat and milk. And when you look deep into the designers of the curriculum, you will find that our education system is actually designed by the companies that want you to buy their products. And so from childhood, they are marketing to you their products. The dairy company, the meat industry, the beverage industry, they are involved in the design of the curriculum. And you know that that's why we are having such big problems with people accepting the health message. But when you start to weed out the false concepts and bringing out Bible-based truth, so you can provide your children with biblical concepts that are honest, that are healthful, then your child will have a good foundation. Okay. I would like us to just finish this part. It's not very big. I have said it's part two, but I think we did part two yesterday. It was supposed to be part three. Of some of the things that you need to consider when you're going to the country. And I say these are just kind of guidelines. Your situation may be different. I don't know if I will have time give our experience. I just don't like to come out there as a standard. I am not perfect. We have not even reached the country yet. We went to Azor, right? Because we had an emergency, the angels literally took our hands from Nairobi and we had to leave. And we realized that, you know, our children were going to get to a level where it will be too late to get them out of the city. We had to move, literally, we had to run from the city. Because, you know, if I say, hey, if you take one more year, our daughter is too late. All right? And so we had to flee from the city, and we were not ready, and we had some piece of land somewhere in the outskirts of Malindi. And so we said, we have a place there, let's just go. And so we went there, and we've been in Zora, and we realized that that is not country. We are able to eat from our garden, but it is a leafy suburb of Malindi. And so we are about to move again from there to the actual country. But we have learned a lot of things in Zoa. I would say we are practicing farming. We have, in a small scale, we have learned how to grow the things that we didn't know, the skills that we didn't have. We have learned how to grow the various kinds of vegetables, how to deal with pesticides, how to deal with the soils. When we got there, when we bought the land, it was not for the purpose of farming. It was just a place we come and put a holiday house. But when we came going to the country, so we needed to farm. And the first day we put down a jembe, it went up. We didn't know that beneath the grass, it was coral. Rock. And so because we were already here and we are not going back, we set about removing the rock. And for 3 months in the blistering heat of Malindi, we removed rock from the garden where we needed to grow. And I think the neighbors thought we had gone crazy. But we finally got to get the rock out and we were able to find a place where we could grow our crops. So one of the things we did there was to have water. We sank a borehole and we found it was slightly salty. So we used it for a while, but then we couldn't use it for our cooking. And so I had to build a tank so that we could harvest water. I just mentioned some of that was there. And we had to depend on the municipal pipe water for our, you know, washing clothes and all that. So that was a problem that always not because sometimes the water will disappear for weeks. It's no water. But not long ago, we managed to dig a well. Just nearby, we dug a well using the normal traditional way of by hand, and we got water that did not have salt. Mm-hmm. And I was scratching my head. I'd actually gone to visit Nathaniel. There is no Nathaniel in Marareni. And Nathaniel has been struggling with the same water problem. At all places, when you sink a bottle, you get water that is salty. And so one time we started digging, asked us to dig a big area, and when they dug, not far, very near the ocean, you can see the ocean there, they found some rock, and they dug, and they went home. When he came in the morning, the place was full of water, and it was fresh water. Yeah. So they said, what's going on here? So when you use the biblical method, digging a well, you're likely to succeed where the conventional methods don't succeed. So when I visited him, I saw that, I said, let me go back to my home and also dig a well. And sure enough, I got fresh water. Within the same compound, the borehole is just about a few meters away, and the well is here. The borehole has salty water, the well has no taint of salt. Right? Except that I'm moving out of the place. But at least now, I disconnected my municipal water in May, and I have no plans of going back. So at least I have done a course in completely cutting off everything. I use power, solar, I use water, and my own food. So that's really the objective of what he wants to do. There are a few things we did wrong when we went to the country, and we will look at some of those, but the Bible, there's a verse in the Bible that, the Bible is very clear what you're supposed to do when you go to the country. And we just get that verse so that you guys can read and get the formula of what you should do when you go to the country. I think it must be in the book of Job. I can get it. It's a very important verse. Proverbs 24, verse 27. Book of Proverbs 24, verse 27. When you go to the country, it says, are you there?
Yes.
Proverbs 24, verse 27. It says, prepare thy work without, and make it fit for thyself in the field. And afterwards, build thy house. You get that formula? Prepare thy work without, and make it fit for thyself in the field. And afterwards, build what?
Thy house.
You see, the Babylonian mentality is that when you get to a place, you put up a house. And once you have a house, then you can now look around and see where you can put a vegetable garden. That's not what you do when you go to the country. The first thing you do when you go to the country is to build your garden. You have to grow your field. You need to grow the food that you need to eat. And once your field has grown, whether it's vegetables or whatever it is that you need to sustain yourself, then you build your house. Why? Because preparation of land can be very costly. It's very expensive to clear land, especially if it's virgin land. It costs a lot of money to cut down the trees, clear the debris, destamp, that is removing all the stumps, until it is to a level like what you've been seeing around here where the boats are plowing, or where you can put a tractor. All right? That costs a lot of money. And so the money you have when you're going out there, you should put it first in the field. You prepare the field. If possible, look for your sources of water. Once lacking in your mind, you will spend all your money in the house and you will be running the nearest market to buy your vegetables. So you just transfer the city to where? To the country. Alright? And often you find the land very far from the market. And so eventually you will get tired and go back where? To the city. Because you have no food. Alright? But if you start with preparing your work outside, and then after that you can build your house, you can live in a tent. It's not a big deal. And usually the man should go fast and prepare the place. When it's ready, he can come and bring his family back. Alright? If you must leave all of you, you can stay in a tent. Abraham lived in a tent all his life. And he did have a problem. Okay? It's in the Bible. He never built a permanent house. Alright? So that is the thing we have learned the hard way. I didn't do that when we went to Malindi. I went here with the Nairobi mentality. The first thing I did was to put up a house. And did I not spend money on that house? When I remember, I feel like crying. Okay? And so later, I started doing the garden. And then I realized I was in the wrong place. I cannot move the house to my new location. But had I started putting the jembe down the first time I landed, I would have noticed, this is not where I should be. I should be somewhere else. So that I would not have had to invest so much money in that place. So don't make my mistakes, alright? Don't go with that dream house in the country, alright? Prepare thy work in the fields. And then, after what? Give thy house. I'm just giving you those principles that are based in the Bible, okay? And if you try to do it otherwise, you can't. If you have the money, you can do it. You know, man always wants to figure out something else. You know, did God say that we should not eat of that fruit? You can still do that. That's your... But I like to follow the Bible. It's simpler. It saves me money. And it makes sure that I don't return back to the sea. There's some people who have returned to the sea. Yeah, they have gone to the country, they have stayed there 3 months, and they have run back to the city. And when you go back to the city, count at least 1 to 2 years, or even 4 years, before you again, if you succeed, you try to make another migration to the country. So please, if you follow the right procedure, you will not want to run back to the city. Okay, now, there are three pillars of country living: water source, heat source, and the food source. Okay? And those are the key things you must, that are just basic. But you're cooking and drinking water, you have to be very scrupulous about it. Right? And then, of course, you use the water for irrigation. This is a drip irrigation. If you are in a countryside where there is no water, this might be an option. Because it will reduce the volume of water that you need to be able to grow your crops. Irrigation, you make sure that you have water right where you need it. If you can't afford that, you can try using by hand. But if you want to do something that can give you some income, you might even want to invest in a drip kit. Okay? Let's look at the energy source. It is important. We need energy when you're going to the farm. And I'm glad you discussed about biomass, one of the sources of energy. One source of energy that God gave us is trees. The tree for firewood, you just, when you are clearing your shamba, if you have got a new shamba that is virgin, please keep the fire. Keep the debris. We use it for energy. You know, boiling water, especially water. Boiling water is the greatest consumer of energy. Because water needs to be boiled to make sure you kill all the bacteria. Alright? So you will find that boiling water, at least for us, that is the biggest source of energy use. It's the biggest user of energy, right? So it's good to get a place where there are trees. But if there are no trees, you plant them, right? Plant them just about the rain season and plant those trees that can survive through the dry season. I'm just addressing those who are in the worst case scenario. If you are in a place where there's plenty of rain, then it's easy. You can grow your trees. And you can grow trees when they lift the ban on logging, These trees can be a source of income. They don't need attendance once they are taken root. You can almost forget them. And after 4 or 5 years, they will give you a good source of income. Okay? So energy source is important. You need to consider how you will get your energy. You will not always be favored to get to buy gas, and it can be expensive. So if you can make your own gas, if you can get firewood, you can make charcoal, then that will sort out your energy for cooking especially. And if you have a lot of, what was that that the Bible uses when they used to go to war and then they get the things of their enemy? What was the word used? If you have a lot of spoil from Babylon, okay? When you're moving out of the country and you get a lot of spoil from Babylon, then you can have enough solar power that can provide you all the energy you need. You can even have three-phase power with solar. I've seen a hotel in the Masai Mara, or is it in South, that has a huge solar panel. You can dedicate like half an acre. Yes, panels, and you can generate three-phase AC power. You can even use an electric cooker. You can do whatever you need with solar. Solar is the best hidden secret worldwide. Because the moment you know that, you will make these guys lose business. So if you invest in solar energy, it will run your washing machine, it will run your blender, your pump. You will operate your machines for carpentry, or you have a workshop, or you have a pump to, you know, it will do a lot of things. If you have some money to spare, invest in solar energy, all right? You have that. You can also invest in the natural trees that grow, will be a source of energy, okay? The trees, you can grow the different trees. And then there is also another source of energy, solar, and then there is wind. Can you see those hats? For solar panels. This is something that is not formally taught in us, or is taught in a very flimsy way. And so it is something that can make a big difference. I went to the head office of Google in Silicon Valley, and the whole campus, it's a huge campus, runs on solar. It runs on solar, and Google is not small. It's a very big campus. I went to the offices, they ran on solar. And I asked myself, how foolish is Africa that we are spending millions buying generators and supporting a very unprofitable entity that is the sole distributor of power? You don't have to be dependent on the Babylonian system. You can combine solar with wind, so that at night, if you are in a windy place, you can be able to charge your batteries and provide light power, like lighting and stuff. So you can, those are the things you need to think about as you want to invest in the countryside, okay? Light, household, devices such as blenders, drilling, water pump, computers and stuff like that, so that you can prepare your presentation for the next conference, all right? You need that kind of power. Okay. So you have for cooking, you have the three stone, electric, gas, charcoal, water purification. You need a lot of energy for boiling and for lighting household and heating. Household heating, if you are in a cold place and you need to warm yourself, you need fuel, you need wood or what you call it. This thing that this the logs you need to put in your fireplace, right? If you are in a cold place, we don't have it. We have used that in our side of the country. It's very hot. But this side has been quite cool. All right? There's a three stone. I have seen it here, so I'm sure. Take those lessons. Don't think that these guys are just doing this for nothing. Go there and see how the three stone works. When you go to the country, you will be stuck. How to put up a three stone? So take advantage of the time you're here in Rome. There's a three stone outside. Then you see how it works, how to light the fire, how to make sure that the wood is burning. Otherwise, you'll be greatly frustrated when you're trying to start a fire. You know, it can be a feat to light a jiko. It is not a mean science. I mean, it's quite a challenge to light a jiko. If I ask you guys to light a jiko, you will sweat. Right? So those are the present. need to be able to put up a, you know, you guys have been having your meals sometimes. And it's because there are some guys who are dedicated in cooking your meals. But if all of us guys were involved in the meals, we would be eating at 9 or 10 o'clock. You've been seeing us guys coming here late. And you don't just think that we like to sleep. Sometimes we have to wake up in the morning and we have to cook our food. Where is Mama Jasper? We have to prepare our food ourselves. We don't have somebody who is dedicated to do that work. And so when we finish cooking, you will find when you're in the countryside, if you are not organized, your meals will always be at 9 or 10 o'clock. When you are struggling, you light the fire. And because you have to do everything yourself. There is no maid to do that kind of work. It is yours. That is your problem. So you must, it will teach you stand discipline. To be, make sure you're up by 5 o'clock, you've had your devotion. At 6 o'clock, you have your family worship. And then you are ready to start making your breakfast. And if you didn't do some preparations the day before, like soaking the beans or, you know, picking whatever, you know, you will find that now you are going to have your breakfast at 10 o'clock. And you have a class that is supposed to start at 8 o'clock with the children. And you need to go to the shower. So it teaches you how to organize yourself. Okay? You need to boil your water, please. You need to boil your water. Right? These are some of the modern purification technologies like UV light, which can use your solar energy. If you can get the money, that will simplify your work. Okay? They are not expensive if you get them from abroad. A system like this might be about 15,000-20,000 if you get it from outside. It is from here, it costs more. Right? Ultraviolet light kills nearly all the bacteria that you find in the water. Okay, now, the other uses. You're going to do stuff. You're going to have your workshop so that you can fix your chairs, you can blend your food, you can photocopy material because you're going to teach. You are a teacher. You're going to teach in the Sabbath school that you're going to start. You have children there, you have people who don't know the truth, and you have these materials that Zadok and his friends have been showing you. So you will discover, hey, where was that presentation that a friend was teaching us on registered by faith? So that you can go and so you need a photocopy so that you can give them hard copy. Alright? So you need that energy to do that kind of thing. Alright? So that's the one I was telling you needs for eating. Of course, I would love to have that kind of house, but I don't know if you can have that. Alright. So the other thing you consider is the food source. And that's what we learned, that you need to make your field, make sure that it is ready before you put up your house. Okay? You need to grow your own food. And I didn't get time, but we have a big problem with GMO food, hybrid food. Sometimes you take the prescription that the commissioner will give you and they don't work and you wonder why. It's because the food that we have, the hybrid seeds, are very efficient in the nutritional content. If you can get heirloom seeds that have not been tampered with, seeds that are natural that you can replant, they will have a higher content of nutrition than the hybrid one you buy in the shop. And then you start seed banking. When you got, you planted your maize with the yellow maize or the red maize, you can bank the seeds, okay? So that you can plant in the next season. So you can grow your tomatoes, and you can grow your vegetables, and you can water them, right? Okay. You can see that even the president, the former president's wife, she had a garden at the White House. Did you know that? She was eating from her garden because she knows the problem of the food in the market. Okay. I think that we are almost done. And so we need, the other final thing is financial support while you're in the country. How do you support yourself? That has been the big question, right? And so what we have been taught is that we should support ourselves from agriculture, from food industries, and from trade. Okay? And let's see, what does it say? As the people of God approach the perils of the last days, Satan holds earnest consultation with his angels as to the most successful plan of overthrowing their faith. He sees that the popular churches are already lulled to sleep by his deceptive power. But at least in sophistry and lying wonders, he can continue to hold them under his control. Therefore, he directs his angels to lay their snares, especially for those who are looking for the second advent of Christ and endeavoring to keep all the commandments of God. Says the great deceiver, we must watch those who are calling the attention of the people to the Sabbath of Jehovah. And they will lead many to see the claims of the law of God. And the same light which reveals the true Sabbath reveals also the ministration of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary and shows that the last work for man's salvation is now going forward. Listen, hold the minds of the people in darkness till that work is ended, till the ministration of Christ in the most holy place is ended. Hold their minds, okay? And we shall secure the world and the church also. You guys were learning about the sanctuary this afternoon, listen. The devil wants us to be held until that work is ended. I will influence popular ministers to turn the attention of their hearers from the commandments of God. That which the scriptures declare to be a perfect law of liberty shall be represented as a yoke of bondage. The people accept their ministers' explanations of scripture and do not investigate for themselves. Therefore, by working through the ministers, I can control the people according to my will. You see, the prophet was shown this a long time ago. But our principal concern is to silence this sect of Sabbath keepers. We must excite popular indignation against them. We will enlist great men and worldly wise men upon our side and induce those in authority to carry our purposes. But before proceeding to these extreme measures, we must exert all our wisdom and subtlety to deceive and ensnare those who honor the true Sabbath. We can separate many from Christ by what?
Worldliness.
By worldliness, lust, and pride. They may think themselves safe because they believe the truth. But indulgence of appetite or the lower passions, which will confuse judgment and destroy discrimination, will cause their fall. Go make the possessors of lands and money drunk with the cares of this life. Present the world before them in its most attractive light, that they may lay up their treasure here and fix their affections upon earthly things. We must do our utmost to prevent those who labor in God's cause from obtaining means to use against us. You see that? The devil doesn't want you to get money because he will use it against you. Keep the money in our own hands. Keep the money. The prophet has given us money. Prophecy is for our own good. The devil wants to make sure you are poor. You can't even pay your bus fare to come to Rongo. That makes him happy because you cannot injure his cause. But if you are diligent with your hand and God blesses you, you will be a great threat to his work. The money, the more means they obtain, the more they will injure our kingdom by taking from us our subjects. Make them care more for money than for the upbuilding of Christ's kingdom and the spread of the truths we hate. And we need not fear their influence, for we know that every selfish, covetous person will fall under our power and will finally be separated from God's will. Do you see why the purpose of the trades and the farming we are going to do in the field is not for our selfish gain? If it is for our selfish gain, you are working for the enemy. It is for furthering the cause of Christ. It is for buying Bibles for those who don't have them, and for sponsoring workshops and conferences like this. It is for going to help the sick and buying them, setting up lifestyle centers where they can come and you treat them for free because you have all the food you need in the garden, and then they can accept your truth. But if you go with the mindset of Babylon, no, I want to do a drip kit and 1 acre will give me 500,000. Oh, that's good. So that I can be able to enjoy myself. You are working for the enemy. Selfishness and covetousness are going to make you fall. Okay? So these are some of the things you can do. Please, when you go to the country, the first thing you need to learn about fruits. Fruits are long term. And once fruits start producing like oranges, you forget. They will give you fruit for the rest of your life. Don't just start with vegetables. Okay, vegetables are good, but you need to select a place in your garden and plant these long-term fruits. They take 3, 4, 5 years. But once you have fruits in your garden, you are all set. Most fruits take a long time. Oranges, lemons, mangoes, coconuts. The fruit trees that last a long time, you need to invest in those fruits so that you have a constant supply of a fruit every season that they produce. Guavas, what else? Duquats, what are some of the other fruits? Bananas, all right? Once you've planted them, you just need to check on them once in a while. But after some time they start producing, you will have a garden. Imagine a garden like that. And you know when fruits start producing, they have no control. They produce so much, you have to call a truck to come and take them to the market. Okay? God does his work very well. Those are pears, I think. Those are apples. Apples take a while to develop, but they can grow. And after some time, you will be having very nice looking garden, okay, of apples. And these are yellow lemons, all right? And so you can also do farming, tree farming. Fine, you can just take a section of your shamba and grow and plant trees. And that is a source of firewood, is a source of income, timber, and all this stuff, okay? Those are the different kinds of trees that you can grow. These are the things we were talking about, how to preserve the food when you get plenty. These are food industries. You can have an industry where you preserve your foods, pack them, and sell them. Okay? Vegetable drying. You can dry your vegetables and sell them. This is one of my youth in Central Church who started the business of drying vegetables. And she went to her father's land, and she started from there. And after a year, I think, or a year and a half, she had sold enough, and she bought 15 acres in Buruchara. And she's a very small, petite girl. And she has a bicycle. And she's staying in a tent. But she had bought her own land from drying vegetables and selling dried vegetables. So if you are diligent, and this is a girl, she had a job in the city. And she resigned. And she went to the country. And today she's self-sufficient. And she's not married. So you don't have to wait for your husband to do this thing. You can do it. Don't wait for this guy, because you might get a husband who loves the city. So what do you do now? In mangoes, in the food industry, you can set up mango juice making and stuff like that. Okay? Alright, you can processing mangoes, and you will get to learn those making juice, and you will be providing people with juice. Right. You have to learn those things once you've grown your crop and you're seeing these fruits are going to start yielding, so what do I do? Okay? Pineapples. So there are other crops that you put there and you forget. I was being told that pineapple is a very good cure for cancer. I didn't know. So it's not only good commercially, but it will be good for your medical mission as well. Okay? That's a pineapple plantation. I want you guys to think about it. Think big. You know, it is because we do not try, and sometimes we disappoint God. So you are thinking of going to the country and buying 1 acre. Do you see all the things that you need to do? Is 1 acre going to be enough? It will not be enough. So get to a place where land is affordable. It's cheap, so you can buy a lot. More space is better. Okay? You will spend the same amount of money you buy in a smaller place that is expensive. So that you can have a plantation like that, and you get a harvest, and you will take all of us to Rongo, and you don't have to pay any money. Okay? You will buy enough Bibles to give those people out there when you're going to do your mission. Okay? So you can process the pineapples, hand them, and sell them. Okay? We are still pineapple processing. That is one of the mango avocados. You know, this side of Kenya, avocados grow very well. Okay? You can plant avocados, and you can process them. Okay? And that is how they are being processed. Avocado, you heard that avocado seed is very good remedy, isn't it? Mm. Yeah. The oil is very expensive and very good. Okay? So those are some of the things that you can do. This is in Kenya. The world hiding and complaining how God has not blessed us. Those are melons. Now, I'll tell you something about melons. Melons are the most heavily sprayed crop. They are the most dangerous things to eat because they use the commercial pesticides. So here you have an opportunity to grow melons organically that are safe, and you can sell at a premium. People who know and are interested in healthful living can come and buy your melon. So you can spend time and see how can I make sure I can keep away the pesticide, the pests, without using toxic chemicals. So this is an opportunity here for us to preach the message of health reform without breaking the eighth commandment. Thou shalt not kill. Okay? So those are melons, that is how they run. Think big. You know, don't just grow melon in a small egg. Then you can have a bunch. The Bible says that he that sows little, he reaps little. So that is something that you can think about. There are some of the traits. You can teach yourself how to fix doors so that when you live near our place, you can come and help me fix my door. Right? So those are some of the traits you can use that can be useful in the countryside. Okay? This is a country. Workshop and for some of the tools you need to buy, and that is putting up a wall there, and help you to work with the helping hands that you might have, so that you are not completely green on how to do it. Okay? You need somebody fixing a tap. You know, when the tap is leaking, then you can be able to fix it. Okay? You don't have to wait for the plumber to come. Okay. Alright, and that is an electrical meter, and you can see there, if you learn a few basics, some of this information is available out there. So you can learn how to check when there is a fault in your house, and see what can be done about it. That is publishing. These are some of the things you were asked to do in this last day. I'm glad to see some of the materials they have been sharing out here. That is a form of publishing, you know, so that we can share the truth to many people. So we need to learn how to publish some of the materials that we have prepared. Okay? There is a much greater work developing upon the individual members of the church than they realize. They are not away to the things of God. The time has come when every means should be devised and aid in preparing people to stand in the day of God. We must be wide awake, refusing to let precious opportunities pass and improve. We must do all that we possibly can to gain souls. Love God and keep His commandments. I don't know if I closed the windows of the car. I'm not sure. Right? We must do all that we possibly can to win souls to love God and keep His commandments. Jesus requires this of those who know the truth. Is this humane and reasonable? Have we not the life of Christ as our example? Do we not owe the Savior a debt of love, of honest and selfish labor for the salvation of those for whom He gave His life? Many of the members of our large churches are doing what? Comparatively, nothing. They might accomplish a good work if instead of crowding together, they would scatter into places that have not yet been entered by the truth. Trees that are planted too thickly do not flourish. Okay? They are transplanted by the gardener, but they may have room to grow and not become dwarfed and sick. Okay? The same rule would work well for our large churches. Many of the members are dying spiritually for want of this reward. They are becoming sickly and inefficient. Transplanted, they are grown to grow strong and vigorous. So when we are crowded together, we can't grow. When we are thrown in a far place and you have to prepare a sermon every Sabbath, you have to grow. You have to study your word, the Bible, and be ready to share. And in the process, you will grow. It is not the purpose of God that these people should organize themselves together in large communities. The disciples of Christ are His representatives upon the earth, and God designs that they should be scattered all over the country. In the towns, cities, and villages are lights amidst the darkness of the world. They are to be missionaries for God, by their faith and works, testifying to the near approach of the coming city. The lay members of our churches can accomplish a work which has yet they have scarcely begun. And she moved into new places merely for what? all flock together in some place and say, now we are doing God's work. Alright? We need to start that so that we can do this out. We should feed enough for souls, a burden of labor for them, and should make a study how to bring them into the truth. They can distribute our publication, all meetings in their home, become acquainted with their neighbor, and invite them to come to these meetings. As they can let their light shine in true parts. So that is the parting shot from the prophet. When you're going to the country, let us not all that are here move to Emu. Let us not all move to where? To Emu. No, 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 no. Let us scatter. Let us spread and enter areas where nobody will ever go and be a missionary there. Remember, you are a missionary. That is your first thing. And then find a way to sustain yourself. And once you've worked an area, you can be ready to move to another area. May God bless you as you are thinking about heeding the call to go to the country and combine country leading with true education. Teaching from the Word of God. And you find that when you're out there in the country and you have children, you don't even have a choice about schools. You don't have schools when you're where you're going to go. So you have to do homeschooling. And you find that God's plan anticipates all those challenges and has prepared us for that kind of life. I don't need any questions. I'm done. This is my last slide. I am finished with country living. I just have one more session on true education. Any questions? May God bless you as you intend to move to the country. Please take note of all the things we have planned. This presentation will be available. You can get it from organizers here. And take time and study for yourself. Everyone must be convinced. Do not move to the country because you came to Rome or London. That will be a mistake. Let us be like the Bereans, who were ready minds, and they investigated whether these things were so. And when you are convinced, God will guide you each and every step of the way, so that you can make the right move. Each one has a different circumstance. Each one has a different situation. And that is why we must depend on God's guidance. Listen to the still small voice. Lay your problems in front of God and ask Him to solve them. And He will. May God bless you. Let us seek the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you because you are loving and you're kind. And Lord, when you give us a command to do something, you always prepare and provide us the resources to do it. And Lord, you have called us in these last days to get out of the cities, to cut every influence, to sunder every tie, that we can make sure that we don't have anything that will hinder our commitment to your service. I pray, Lord, that you may give us faith and truth, that we can be able to move out in obedience to your way, and Lord, you will guide us like you have the Israelites. There are various things we need to learn, and there are many things we need to unlearn. And Lord, that you taught Moses in the wilderness, that you taught Abraham, and that he left his family, Lord, you promised that you will be with us, even until the end of the age. We pray, Lord, that you bless us and guide us, those who have been here and have listened to your voice, may they make a decision for you, and Lord, commit their lives to be missionaries of God in the divine plan. Let us not be missionaries in our own plans, but let us be missionaries in the plan that you have designed for us. Lord, you know we've not done everything according to your will. We seek that you forgive us. Maybe in our presentation we did not present the truth in the way that we should have done it. We ask that you forgive us for our shortcomings and make up for that our deficiency in expressing the truth correctly in the minds of those that are coming. We pray all this in Jesus' name.